Do not forsake your own friend or your father's friend, nor go to your brother's house in the day of calamity. Better is a neighbour nearby than a brother far away. My name's Arthur. Thank you for joining me as we share some thoughts from Scripture, starting from Proverbs chapter 27, verse 10, talking about friend. But there are several verses in this chapter talking about friends. Verse 6 said, "Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful." Verse 9 said, "Ointment and perfume delight the heart, and the sweetness of a man's friend counsel to the soul." Verse 14 says, "He who blesses his friend with a loud voice, rising early in the morning, it will be counted a curse to him." Throughout Scripture, there are many people who are described as friends. A person who is a friend is one who is a companion that you share part of your life with, and they share part of your life with. And the idea of this proverb is that we need such people in our lives. We need to have friends, and we need to recognize the importance of friendship in our relationships. So do not forsake your own friend or your father's friend. Because somebody has been your father's friend, he has blessed you as well, and you need to return that blessing. And this relationship of friendship can be even greater than the relationship you have with a natural brother. So he says, "Nor go to your brother's house in the day of calamity. Better is a neighbour nearby than a brother far away." We are to make friends with those who are nearby. This is why we are to love your neighbour as yourself. Make your neighbour your friend. Spend time talking with them, listening to them, sharing with them. Now, there are warnings, of course, about who you make as friends and how far you go with your friendship. You don't want to just follow your friend to do that which is evil in desperation for friendship. Some people get caught up into gangs because they want to be part of something. We are not to do evil as a result of our friendship, but we are to do good. When Abraham came to the land of Canaan, just with his wife and his property, he allied himself with the three brothers, Mamre, Eshcol, and Aner, who were Amorites. No doubt they had some very hearty discussions and investigations together. And so when Lot was taken away by the Chaldeans, Abraham joined with his friends to go and rescue him. The remarkable thing is that Jesus called his disciples his friends, not his servants. His friends because he gave himself to them. They weren't just employed to do his work, but they were to enter into a relationship with him where they could discuss things, where they would spend time on the road, where they would explore the meaning of life together. And then they could enter into his ministry, not just as servants, but as partners, as collaborators. And in all Christian ministry, it's not to be a one-man effort. It's always to be in partnership with others. So when Jesus sent his disciples out, it was always two by two. They went together. When Paul went on his missionary journey, he had Barnabas initially, and Silas, and later Timothy, others, Luke, part of the team. These people were not just team members who had independent lives but came together for the purpose of the gospel, but they became very close collaborators together to share the goals and aspirations. And so while natural relationships between brothers are important and we are not to despise our brothers, there is a friend who is closer than a brother. In the day of calamity, these people are the ones that we turn to. In Luke chapter 11, after reporting to us the Lord's Prayer. Jesus says, "Which of you shall have a friend, and go to him at midnight, and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has come to me on his journey, and I have nothing to set before him.' And he will answer from within and say, 'Do not trouble me. The door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give it to you.' I say to you, though he will not rise and give to him because he is his friend, yet because of his persistence, he will rise and give him as many as he needs." So the scenario is, a friend comes visiting. He's been traveling. I need to feed him before I put him to bed, and I don't have anything to feed him with. So you turn to your friends. You can impose upon your friend because of your need. This is what happens. Even though the friend is a bit grumpy about having to get out of bed at midnight when it's all nice and comfy and cozy, yet he will do so when he understands the need that you have. As I reviewed some of the verses referring to friends, I noticed that when Judas Iscariot came to Jesus to betray him, Jesus calls him friend. So to be betrayed by your friend is a very serious matter. Jesus had shown love and grace and patience, had walked with Judas. The prophecy concerning him was that your own familiar friend has raised up his hand against you. And there is a great sense of betrayal when your friend is the one who betrays you. But Jesus never justified Judas's action. Jesus, even at the last moment, entreated him, calling him friend, as he had spoken to all his disciples. Indeed, in Luke chapter 7, verse 34, we read, "The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, 'Look, a glutton and a winebibber, a friend of tax collectors and sinners.'" Jesus made himself a friend of anyone who he could make contact with, even those who the religious people despised. They separated themselves, but Jesus did not separate himself from the ordinary people who were not particularly religious, who were just going on with their business. He got involved in their lives and is called their friend. This doesn't mean that he approved of any evil that they were doing, but it does mean that he engaged with them. He shared his life with them. He entered into discussion with them. And in such a way, he was able to challenge them about their priorities of life, not in a confrontational way, but in the way of friendship. This is the way that we can be his representatives on earth, reaching out to people in their own circumstances, not coming in saying, "You must do this and you must do that," but entering into their lives, meeting them in their needs and circumstances, and showing them the way of the Lord Jesus. Among the final words that Jesus spoke with his disciples before he was crucified are these: "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another, as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all things that I heard from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. These things I command you, that you love one another." Abraham was a friend of God, and God answered his prayers. And Jesus wants to be your friend and to answer your prayers.